Welcome to Flop Soup, a podcast about pop culture and flop culture. I'm Justin.
And I'm Cassandra, and we're the Tortured Poets Department. Just kidding. More on
the TPD.
The TPD. We're the TPD. We're getting t-shirts.
Not the police department.
Yeah, we're the police department.
Okay, yeah. If we start now, we will not stop. Yeah, we're gonna just circle back.
So hit me with it. We'll circle back. We'll circle back.
How else are you flopping this week?
Thank you, Justin, as always, so much for asking. I'm flopping this week because today I got hit with your T-Mobile Netflix plan has changed. There are ads now message. Yes, this diva has T-Mobile.
Hi, diva.
And through it, she gets Netflix. except now that plan is including ads. But then here's the secret surprise flop on Netflix's end. I started watching episodes of Ugly Betty and actually no ads played. So it was like I saw the marker for where the ad should play and no ad.
Is Ugly Betty not monetized these days?
Are the girls not tuning in for their rewatchings? I okay. guess like there's no money to be had from those ads. Like, okay. So that was pretty much like, fuck.
And what then even I was is like, a Netflix ad?
Like, right. I don't know. And that's I watched to see like what would be advertised to me, but it's right now it's nothing. But I do have a feeling that it's like gonna be psoriasis medication.
She found it. The feeling of finding the psoriasis treatment she's been looking for.
Absolutely. I'm watching the Grammys lot, or at least on Paramount Plus. I was like, oh, another pharmaceutical ad. Oh, another pharmaceutical ad. Yeah. Oh, great. Oh, here's another one. Better talk to my doctor. Yes.
I haven't done a study, but I would approximate that 99% of ads that air on live TV are pharmaceutical ads. If I had to put a number on it, it would be like every single one except for like a couple.
Yeah, and for the most part, I've been blessed to be ad-free on most of my streaming services, but for Paramount Plus, I just could not stomach it, so I was like, okay, we're gonna be watching these ads tonight, and I was reminded of what that looks like.
Pharmaceuticals, it looks like.
Yes.
Like, do I have psoriasis, and do
pills,
I need that?
Potions.
Right,
yeah.
Exactly. So yeah, that's how I'm flopping this week. I'll report back when an ad does play, because I do wonder also, do I want to be watching Ugly Betty if there are ads? I think it could change whether or not I need to have
value.
That show on.
True.
So we'll see. We'll see. Yeah. But Justin, I will flip it back to you and say, how are you flopping this week?
Vanderpump Rules premiered its 11th season this past week. And I don't know whether or not it's good or bad as a show anymore, but I listen to so many recap podcasts surrounding it that it doesn't even matter. And everyone else is doing the work, these content creators. But one that I'm really loyally listening to is called Rachel Goes Rogue. Do you remember who Rachel is?
Is that that's Raquel Leviss?
That's her new given name. Yeah. Okay. Her real name.
Okay. Her real name.
Her government name is Rachel.
Right.
Yeah, Raquel had too much pizzazz.
Let me just check in. How many recap podcasts are there?
Oh, there's so many. Like, there's just, I don't even know how many there are, but there's at least three that I sometimes check in on between episodes.
And so Rachel's not on the show, but she's recapping it. Is that what's going on?
Rachel Goes Rogue started off as her clearing the air and like telling truths and speaking truth to power.
Okay.
And then it was like, oh, the new season's coming out. I better recap that because that's probably good content that people want. So she's recapping it. And I love it too, because it's like, she's been through this whole like treatment facility journey, and she's already been through like, she's had a therapist on to like tell her why she like does the things she does and lives her life the way she does. And then she's now saying, oh, I'm going to recap the show that put me in this situation that I'm in of being like one of the most hated women in the nation for a year. So doing that.
So she rebranded as a recap podcast. Great.
Yeah, exactly. And it's hilarious too, because it's her. She's the person, but she also has the iHeartRadio production team like asking her questions on the podcast, because she isn't the type of person to be a one woman podcaster show.
She can't generate it all.
She can't do that. So there's like, and my iHeartRadio team is here to ask me questions. And they're like, so Rachel, like, you know, blah, blah, blah. You'd
think they could just like assign her a friend. Do you know what I'm saying? Like,
yeah.
Can you not just like produce a person?
Right. Yeah. Just don't even call it the iHeartRadio team. Just here's my friend. Her name's Stephanie. She has
Make
some questions
up.
For me. Yeah.
Industry it's plant. Her name is definitely Stephanie. Like,
yeah.
That's what people want. They don't want like one sort of insane woman. Like,
hello. Cassandra and I are both industry plants, if you couldn't tell.
Exactly.
And we've just been
we're industry plants. We are created for each other. Isn't that beautiful?
Yeah, that's how you get this dynamic and this chemistry.
Exactly.
You know, they can only be created in a lab.
In a lab.
So, yeah.
Well,
it's just
well...
floppy to be like, oh, time to watch my Rachel Goes Rogue. Better go rogue this week.
Yeah, right. It's time to go rogue. We're going rogue heads.
I love
that you're like, everyone is just kind of like, we're not sure if the show's good. Like, where do you go from like, this is literally the most insane reality television moment of all time to like, okay, it's back and all of that resolved.
Right. It's the framing is now we're picking up the pieces, which is not as fun as we're shattering the glass. You know
right.
what I mean?
People who love reality TV, you want to see the glass shatter, I think.
Right. We want to
That's
like
what
bash
I get
in windows
you.
With baseball bats and then
right.
you have to pick up the shattered glass afterwards. That does not sound fun to
That's
me.
That's not so interesting. Right.
Time will tell
like,
if
that
this
sounds
is
like
fun.
A consequence.
Yeah.
Which I'm not interested
that.
In. Yeah.
Yeah, we hate that.
Okay. So we're both super flopping. Great.
In the TV sphere.
In the
More TV
sphere.
Later.
In the TV sphere.
Sphere.
More on that later. Next up.
Quick flops.
Here we go. Special Dune 2 AMC exclusive popcorn bucket looks like a fleshlight. Are you Mean Girls popcorn weed box daughter or Dune 2 popcorn fleshlight son? You have to answer.
I actually can't believe that this wasn't an AI-generated deep fake popcorn bucket ad. I truly can't.
It's unbelievable.
Like, we're really doing this.
What AMC? Is this like the fourth time we've had to cover AMC doing an exclusive? Like, what is going on over there with whoever is coming up with these products? They're like, I want the most disgusting cocktail of all time, and we're going to pair it with the most iconic musician of all time. Are you ready? I'm talking about the Beyonce cocktail. Like, are
you
ready for this?
Well, you didn't see the Aquaman cocktail.
Right.
But
the Aquaman cocktail actually seemed better.
You know.
They were like, we're going
to
make a slightly better
yeah.
cocktail for Aquaman.
Yeah.
And then now they're like, why don't we make the popcorn bucket look like a fleshlight?
And a weird alien fleshlight too. Like one of those like tentacle porn ones, you know, it's like
right.
Teeth.
It has, it's giving teeth. It's giving that movie teeth where
and
vagina
you reach
has
your
teeth.
Hand into it each time you want some AMC delicious popcorn.
Some AMC popcorn. And it's like the teeth of it are going to knock the popcorn out of your hand is what I
and
wanted.
That's
from
painful.
A function, from a functional viewpoint, like that's disgusting. And what
that's
happens
trauma.
If, what happens if something gets in there that shouldn't be in there? Like what if you just drop a little something and you're like, oh no, I had to take that out. You couldn't find it. It's too dark because mm-hmm. of the teeth. Did we say that yet? It's shaped like
oh, yeah.
a sand. It's shaped like the sandworm from Dune.
The sandworm Shai Halud is.
Yeah, yes. Anyway, it really looks like a fleshlight.
Next up, speaking of sandworms, Demi Lovato performed her hit song Heart Attack at an event for the American Heart Association of all places. When asked about this unfortunate choice, a representative for Lovato explained, quote, she spoke on the mind-heart connection. It was a sensitive moment intended to champion the women in the room. The first thing this reminded me of is the iconic moment of Beyonce doing the song Diva at a 9/11 tribute. And famously in the song Diva, she has a part where she goes, no passengers on my plane. And she does like a plane motion.
It's really giving like nobody told these girlies what they were, where they were about to be.
Where they were at the moment, yes.
You
it's
know,
like
they're
the
just
car,
being like launched.
Do
it's
your
like,
best song.
Do the normal set list. Go. And nobody was like, and where are we? And who are the people out there. I mm-hmm. The mind heart connection. She spoke on the mind heart connection. I mean, that is PR stroke of genius. A true nonsense sentence. I love to see it. I really do.
Oh. Because isn't the song is I have a crush and this is what a crush feels like. It feels like a heart attack. And the women in the room were like, well, we've had heart attacks. I don't
we've
know
had
if it
that.
Feels
yeah,
similarly.
Right. Yeah. Like, I'm not sure that that's the same. Like,
cardiovascular
this song,
events.
This song is, like, literally, like, I'm, like, trying not to fall in love, but I'm painting my nails and stuff.
Like
it's
a girl.
Like, is that... like a girl.
She does
want,
say that.
Make me want to act like a girl.
Her best song. No.
Her best song. And that's a confusing part of it for her, for sure. It's her best song.
Wait, I did my best song. Why do you guys not live?
I hope that they sue. That would be really funny.
What song should she have done? Like, Cool for the Summer?
Cool for the Summer. Cool for the Summer.
Why were we both like, I would love to hear that again.
Just play Cool for the Summer. That's like the next song.
Because Demi has made so many like, I'm empowered now songs that there are many she could have chosen from that would have vaguely fit an empowerment theme. Skyscraper. She sang that for the alien ghosts, remember? So
agree. Yeah. Agree. Anyway. So okay, we have ideas. Pay us.
You get this
Ben
one.
Lucky me. Ben Shapiro released a rap single called Facts, that's all capital letters, last week, which just debuted at number 16 on the Billboard Hot 100, outpeaking Nicki Minaj's diss track to Meg Thee Stallion, Bigfoot.
We had to include that last part there because that is
It's speaking to the moment. It's speaking to the moment. But Ben Shapiro is, of course, a famous, like, insane conservative commentator who once commented on the validity of the concept of a wet-ass pussy and said that my wife is a gynecologist and it's a problem if your pussy is this wet. So now
he's in the rap game.
He's outpeaking Nicki Minaj's newest track. So
not much more to say on that besides I did actually take a little bit of a listen to the song and it does sound exactly like what you would think a Ben Shapiro rap song would sound like, if that makes sense.
Yeah, like Lil Dicky like hit his head.
Yeah, like dorky Eminem, like Eminem a little bit nasally and bad.
And, right, know. And being like, yeah. I am conservative, whoa.
Woke mob was said.
Woke mob came after me.
Yeah. So stupid. Next up, it was revealed last week that Congresswoman Kyrsten Sinema, who is famous on this podcast for selling her personal belongings on Facebook Marketplace during her work hours.
Diva.
It was revealed that she has spent over $200,000 in taxpayer funds on private chartered jet travel since 2020. Noting that is her Senate office budget as a whole.
Yeah, so she spent the Senate office budget, which I guess was probably for staplers and staff, and she was like, I have to get on a plane.
These papers will just have to litter
the floor.
Just
be everywhere.
Unstapled.
This article also had a fun comparison to the other Arizona senator spending literally zero of his Senate budget on chartered jet travel, so...
Oh, I thought it was just he spent none of his budget, which is like, you should spend some of that budget to like...
Oh, no. He just never used any of it on chartered private jet travel because senators are not supposed to do that because that's not really an accepted practice. So, but you know what? If you want to be like Taylor Swift, you have to get on a private jet. So maybe that's where she's coming from.
That is feminism.
And that's feminism. Moving on. Paris Hilton revealed she will release her second studio album in June, and it will be executive produced by Sia, to which we say, do we need Sia produced music in the year 2024? Do we need that?
Do we need Sia at all?
At all.
Do we need Paris Hilton music at all?
I'm thinking no.
I'm thinking Stars Are Blind is a classic and we should just leave it at that. I don't know if Paris Hilton music is going to like do that again.
You're right. I'm thinking that she doesn't have another one in her, but who knows? Maybe we'll see it in M3GAN sequel, M4GAN, maybe.
We would hope. Next up, Stanley Cups apparently contain, quote, some lead, Hydro Flask corporate espionage going into full effect. Instead, Hydro Flask would like you to know that they use a proprietary sealant called, quote, Temp Shield trademark, which we are sure is very good for your health.
Good for our health, for sure.
Yeah, it's not made of rat poison. It's not made of lead.
The like American Medical Association, they were like, our recommendation, if you can't have lead, you should use the Hydro Flask proprietary sealant Temp Shield. That should be what you're exposed to.
Great. Great
that
set.
Should be the next thing. So, okay,
everything's
great.
Amazing. Don't drink all out of glasses.
All of our water bottles are health.
Yeah,
right.
So good.
Don't touch a glass. You need a reusable water bottle that has a scary chemical in it.
You need at least 8 of them.
And they should take up a scary amount of space in your cabinet that makes your husband angry.
He's always angry. That's it for our quick flops this week. Next, we're going to get into our hot flopics. It's hot. The moment we've been waiting for. It's award show season still, and we are still at it. The Grammys happened yesterday as of recording. But starting off with a positive, I feel like we kind of enjoyed ourselves as like a concert venue, right?
Yeah,
like,
as a concert, this worked.
Right.
Like, as just like, okay, we got some people together and they're going to sing song.
Right, like thoughtfully curated performances for the most part.
So that was great. I mean, we opened with Tracy Chapman, shortly followed by... by Luke Combs. Oh, sorry. I mean, by we opened with.
For each other.
By we opened with, I just meant like, you know, up top and sort of when I turned the television on. So what happened was when I turned the television on is when Tracy Chapman was there. And I saw no videos of Dua Lipa performing. So it's almost like it didn't happen. Like, do you know what I'm saying? I went on Twitter and there was like zero evidence that she was there.
If there's no gay guy screaming about Dua Lipa on Twitter, did she even perform?
Did she even perform? And what did you perform? Houdini?
Well, sort of, kind of.
So she did a medley. Okay, let me fill you in.
Oh, great.
Because I was one of those
is
gay
she
guys
at a,
screaming.
Is she at a medley point? Is she at a point of medley?
So here's the thing. And it's a floppy medley because your medley has a song no one's heard yet and isn't out and isn't available for purchase until 2 weeks from now.
Definitely that, not at a medley point.
Not loving that part. But I do like the song sample. It's called Training Season. I do enjoy it. It's a little catchy bop. I was a Houdini hater, but now I love it. I love it all. I'm like,
wow.
let's all do it. Now, I think now that Dua Lipa is kind of like not ubiquitous, I'm kind of like, let's engage.
She's so underground. Like, let's get back into her.
Yes, this indie artist, Dua Lipa. Yeah. and she had like, you didn't see any of it? She had like a jungle gym. She was like, it was like rotating. She had like gay guys moving the thing around. I was entertained.
Yeah, I caught like the last 4 minutes of Trevor Noah's monologue, I guess, and then right into Fast Car.
Thank God.
But Dua Lipa did the choreography. I need to stop talking about Dua Lipa. But she did the choreography that is very...
You can't. I can tell.
very fine-tuned for her abilities. Not amazing cat-cat boom choreography, but like it was suited for her. It was curated. It was bespoke choreography for Dua Lipa.
We love that for her. Mm-hmm. That's amazing.
Who else performed that we liked?
I think chronologically it was like Tracy Chapman and Luke Combs, which Tracy Chapman famously doesn't perform in public like almost ever, so it's amazing they got her. Miley did her like incredible charismatic performance of Flowers,
injected charisma and star quality into a song that is so bad
nearly
beige,
it's so
like who cares,
I don't want to hear that again. And yet when she sings it in person, I'm like, play it again, girl.
Right. And we're saying this is just like haters. This song is one of the biggest songs of the year.
I think I told this story on the podcast that like when I was in Portugal, it was the only current song that they played at the club. They were like, we have one song that we want to listen to from this year. Everything else is old hits. Like,
does it sound like it's made for the club? No, but we're going to fucking play it.
But we're playing it at the club.
Yeah.
Miley Cyrus, and she just did an incredible nonsense thank you speech when she won that first award. She was like, there's a butterfly. I love you, Mariah Carey. And this song was my butterfly. And it was like, whatever you say, girl, you are having so much fun. Your hair looks like Jane Fonda in the 70s for some reason. And then she just slayed the house down.
Slay, yes, mama.
She did a little like riff at the end of the song with her amazing fucking rock star voice. I was like, hell yeah, she looked awesome. Really good. And then we had SZA.
Really good. I like am wearing a SZA thing. I'm such a control girl. I love control, the concept, and also the album. I've just been struggling lately with her live. I don't know. It feels AI, the vocal. I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know. I'm a little scared.
It's hard for me to weigh in here because I have to share that I don't care about her music at all.
All right, clap if you think she should suffer.
I just,
it's fine.
I try so hard and I'm always like, I don't really know what she's saying.
Yeah.
And it's a little too chill for me, maybe.
Yeah.
And so when I see her perform, all I can think to myself is I'm so happy for all my people that I know that like her, but it's not me. Mm-hmm. And so I can't even rate that. I don't even know what it should sound like, but I believe you. I wasn't moved. I'm not moved by her live performance in any way. I'm not like, suddenly I get it.
It felt like a lot of, I mean, I guess you could say the same for Dua Lipa, like Smoke and Mirrors. Like there's just a lot of production going on, but I think it's very noticeable for SZA's live performances because the songs I feel like don't really need so much choreography and production. Like they are smooth R&B tracks that are very like, let's get into this vocal. And yet she has swords and she has people like doing the Kill Bill like homage
like
in a way.
Thing, yeah.
Yeah. And it's like, I get that. But sometimes there's just so many moves squeezed into like one syllable for a SZA song. It doesn't always make sense to me. And I love her. I do love her. I've seen her live before. But I don't know. Something about that performance like didn't fully gel or like click for me. Even though there was a lot going on, it just didn't like make sense.
Yeah, so. For sure. And so, yeah. So that one was not so good. And then she performed again in a Mastercard commercial.
Wait, yeah. That actually stopped me dead in my tracks. I was like refilling a chip bowl and like was in the kitchen. And I heard, that's why I'm partnering with Mastercard to save the trees. Wait, huh? Like, what's happening?
Right, like, what's going on? I was, like, texting, and then I looked up, and I was like, oh, she's performing again? That's weird. And right. Then I was like...
Oh, she's in an AI forest.
Oh, it's for MasterCard, and it was 90 full seconds. Like, yeah, oh?
A song no one's heard, also, which was interesting as well.
Which was a really confusing part of it. It was very like, yeah. Why am I suddenly watching SNL? Oh, wait, it's an ad. Like, the MasterCard ad from SZA definitely in the flop category of the night of like, what is it that we're doing here? You know, like, what's the...
Yeah.
Pourquoi indeed.
I just think the, and that's why I'm partnering with blank, is like... It's tough to sell, you know?
It's definitely tough to sell. And what was the angle? Was like global warming?
For sure. It was MasterCard's going to plant some trees in my name. And I saw actually, you can like, if you comment on her Instagram post about it, she'll send you a seed.
And what are like the what's the offset of the shipping cost? Like, where does MasterCard make their credit cards? Like, sorry, like, can you tell me where MasterCard has their stock?
Yeah. Okay. Not carbon negative, not carbon neutral, carbon positive. we're reframing contributing to global warming as carbon positive.
Yeah, carbon positive. It's hot. MasterCard acknowledges carbon.
We're aware of carbon. We are in proximity.
We know about it. And yeah. Because we've heard of it, we're going to plant a tree for SZA, but only SZA. We won't plant any other trees. We're only going to do it because she sang her little song. Enlisted. We didn't even get into, which is reminding me of later when the head of the Recording Academy was naming all of the music tragedies that had occurred.
Well, you don't want to hear about 9/11.
This was the funniest thing that happened all night, was that the Recording Academy guy came on stage. He listed a bunch of like terrorist events at music events. So like Ariana Grande bomb, the Las Vegas shooting that was at a country music festival, which is like the biggest mass shooting in American history. He names that. And then in front of him, a string quartet is playing. And he goes, and that's why we have in front of us an Israeli, a Palestinian, and people of Arab descent playing music all together to show peace and harmony. And it's like, what just happened to me? What have I just witnessed?
You've witnessed corporate DEI in effect. like that's corporate DEI messaging
like,
core.
Just, oh yeah. My God. Was it tone deaf? Was it, these things are not like the other? Like, what are you talking about? Like,
right.
That was actually, probably the floppiest moment of the night. We have other floppy moments that we'll go over, but I just forgot.
They're all very like whimsical flops.
They're very whimsical, but that one was like a true political dud.
You stepped in that. Yeah, that was like nonsense.
And then also, of course, undercut by another great performance, Annie Lennox did Sinead O'Connor's Nothing Compares to You.
Yeah, it's Call for Ceasefire.
Called for Ceasefire. And then that, I feel like, is like, that was a
And then the Grammys were like, cut the cameras. Yeah.
Right. And then MasterCard they're commercial. Doing that not to be commenting politically, but it was like, so yeah, it's like, play the MasterCard commercial again.
Go.
MasterCard commercial.
Yeah, it was one of those moments. It reminds you that after all, the Recording Academy is a company.
It's a company doing capitalism.
And a board.
They were like, we are gonna have to make I love the idea of like people in a room being like, we have to make a statement. And it's like, it doesn't
any
matter.
Statement, we just have to make
just, like,
it.
Any statement. We have to prove that we've heard of what's happening.
The thing that happened was so sad. We can't believe it got so bad when the stuff we know occurred.
And people will love that when we do that.
They'll love it.
The Sphere shout out. You two are literally locked in that sphere. They don't let them leave.
There.
They feed on rats in the sphere. They have not seen actual sunlight. They've only seen simulated sunlight from the sphere.
From inside the sphere
itself.
That's right.
They were like, here's you two. And they're like, wait, are those real people out there? Oh my gosh. Wow.
I can't believe it. I'd love to see them. And I loved the intro of being like, this is the first televised footage of the sphere. It's like, okay. My richest cousin posted a video of it on Instagram already. Like, I don't care. Like,
yeah, it looks more interesting in those videos shot from iPhone from people's seats than it did
in the actual video.
Yeah.
Where I was just like, okay, so they are actually just singing, like, kind of in a space, and then I get a little dizzy, and then they're back to singing. Like,
right, yeah. The thing that was missing from a U2 concert experience was being a little dizzy.
It was being just like
they solved it.
A touch dizzy, and they fixed that part of it. And so now you can be dizzy there. Dizzy while they play Vertigo. That's so smart.
4D experience. Let's go.
Anyway, we're so excited for them to give us free tickets there because we do so much promo because for this year.
So much, please. Should we talk about Taylor? Should we set a time box on Taylor?
Yeah.
Should we say more than five?
Let me just say two more things. One is Joni Mitchell performance made me cry. She was amazing. And two, Billy Joel, fine.
Okay. Yeah, next.
That's it. And I think that's all the live performances.
Sorry.
He sounded good. The song sounded fine. I just wasn't like moved. Like Joni Mitchell doing Both Sides Now, like with her like powerful little cane. I was crying. Meryl Streep and her daughter in the audience were crying. Okay. Yeah. We're all crying.
Yeah.
By the way, if you're ever looking to like see people pour their souls out, you should go to a Joni Mitchell video on YouTube and just read the comments.
Oh no, it's like sharing circle.
It's literally like without Joni Mitchell, I would have probably killed myself in 1974. And you're like, wow, okay.
Thumbs up.
Thumbs up. And they're like, I have this video liked.
100 likes, yeah, for sure.
Oh God. Anyway, Taylor Swift, should we do it?
Type 5, type 10 type five. Perhaps. We'll see how long.
Type 12. The dress, the outfit.
The dress, the scaparelli.
It's bad, yeah.
Bad.
Yeah.
Anti-slay.
Just why was
the life out of me from the start?
From
what
the beginning.
What is the hair? What is the styling? The black gloves make your arms look like they don't exist.
She looked like she was wearing a Halloween costume. She looked like she was wearing a Halloween costume.
Yeah, it was like what you would wear if you were dressing up as the Bride of Frankenstein.
The Bride of Frankenstein, which I did this year, and honestly, I look better. That's tough to say. and my outfit was $40 from Amazon, and I looked more cohesive.
You just ended Taylor. You just ended her.
It's tough. Yes. She had a watch as a choker. Like, what are we doing, Diva?
Hi, Diva. You know, I'm just not feeling this one.
I'm sure that's some Easter egg that I don't have the.
Oh yeah, it probably
bandwidth
like
for
like somehow the hands were spelling out like the police department.
The police department.
The police department.
Wow.
So she shows up dressed like shit as usual, like way worse than usual, actually. Sometimes she wears stuff that people dunk on, and I'm like, she looks normal. This one was not, she looks normal. This one was like, why are you doing Bridgerton cosplay that is uglier somehow?
It was vaguely Bridgerton coded. That's what was happening there. That's very.
But
the hair was, what was that hair with the braid?
The hair. So she had a braid on top of her hair. And people were saying, this is the I'm bored in class hairstyle.
Yeah,
because it's just like you will braid your hair in class sometimes, and that's kind of how it would look.
Nonsensical braid, no care for like, where it's placed, where
doesn't
it
matter where it is.
I was talking about like conspiracy theories around like why she always manages to not serve a look. Our friend Chad was saying that I think sometimes her inner business person kicks in, and I think it stops her from looking good. Like Taylor Swift, the business person, can't look good on a runway. It makes her look too inaccessible. And her whole brand is that she is the every woman. And so he was saying, in this case, she's allowed to wear scaparelli, but it can't look good. He was saying, do you think Nancy Grace is wearing her dream outfit every day? No, it's important that she looks like Nancy Grace.
Yeah, and, okay. I mean, that's a good argument. Like her brand is relatable, so she can't look fierce.
Yeah, if she flies too close to the sun, who knows what would happen? I don't know.
Like her sacrifice to the money gods is like, I'll look pretty mid at all times.
It's like a blood pact.
I can be a billionaire. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. But this was like a true bottom of the barrel look. Right. And it was for her to make history. But should we get to that in a second? So I guess we can talk first about she wins for like best pop vocal album.
Right. That was the first award she won of the night that we saw.
Best pop vocal album. She beat like other pop vocal albums, question
she
mark.
She beat Kelly Clarkson Chemistry.
Insane that that was nominated. Like that right? tells you, are they being serious or are they not being serious? Like
it's absolutely unserious. I guess if we're talking about vocals, like sure, but then it's like, why is Taylor there in the same category as Kelly Clark? I don't
it
know.
Doesn't make
it's
any
just
sense.
Weird.
She gets up on stage and she's like, this is crazy. Oh my God. And you know what else is crazy? I have a brand new album. It's
and everyone kind of tenses.
Yeah, everyone tenses. Everyone, by the way, no one is cheering. No one is like tittering.
Everyone's
none of
kind
that.
Of like
silent. Everyone is like, like they pan to like every celebrity there and they're all just like, okay. And she's like, it's a brand new album. It's called the Tortured Poets Department. And then like nobody really cheers because these are not her fans. They're her peers. And then she goes, okay, I'm going to go post about it.
And everyone's like, okay, good luck with that Tortured Poets Department
you speak of.
The reactions were very interesting to me. I think also it's because people are kind of hoping, okay, this might be a year where we can just release our albums and not compete against Taylor Swift. And yet,
right. Oh,
you're doing another album consecutively year after year. That's what we're doing. Okay, so I guess I won't have the biggest album of the year this year. You will, again.
As you always are doing. I guess the only thing that everyone else can hope for is that she just, like, kind of runs out of steam. Like, the people are just like, I can't do more of this. I'm feeling like if it's as mid as Midnight's was, like we might all just be tired of Taylor Swift. Like, if she doesn't really, like, invent a new sound, like, perhaps we'll all just get tired of it, and then somebody else's new album might be able to come in and do something. But I'm personally feeling fatigued with the Taylor's version. Like, I'm upset that she's not just rounding that out. Like, I would like to just finish that journey before we do more Taylor Swift.
If you want to be all galaxy brained about it, what might be crazy is that she is invoking her own backlash and overexposure to recreate the conditions of the original Reputation era. So that when she releases Reputation Taylor's version,
she's in a similar place. Underdog. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna scream. But so she does this, and then she goes and she sits back down, and then SZA wins an award and says, like, hi, Taylor. And then she, like, looks at everyone, and she's like, I got a shout-out to all of her friends. And then that was very, like, all right, Taylor Swift, that's enough from you. And then I will say, okay, I'm down on Taylor Swift, but she stands at all the right moments for performances. She was up for Tracy Chapman when a lot of other people were not up. I'm like, you have to be standing for Tracy Chapman. Like, she really stands, and she claps, and she's like, woohoo! Like, she's a good fan to other people. Okay, I will always be giving her that, because that's an important way to be at these shows, if you're sitting front row.
How she's a bad fan... Talk about Lana, talk about dragging my girl Lana up on stage when she clearly body languaging to you that she does not want to be doing that.
Leave me alone.
Get a good lawyer.
She wins album of the year. Everybody wanted SZA to win.
I feel like everyone was just hoping for anyone else at this point. Like,
aside from her.
It's just like anyone else would have been at least an interesting move from the Grammys or something that's worth chewing on. Like, making space for other artists that are still releasing music despite Taylor Swift's whole era sucking all the air out of the industry, kind of.
All of that stuff. Yeah.
Like,
no,
that would have been cool.
That would have been cool. So the other nominees were Endless Summer Vacation, Miley Cyrus, The Age of Pleasure, Janelle Monáe, World Music Radio by Grammy Darling, John Batiste, The Record by Boy Genius.
I take that back.
The Record by Boy Genius, SOS by SZA, Guts, Olivia Rodrigo, and Did You Know That There's a Tunnel Under Ocean Boulevard by Lana.
Okay, I amend my statement to say anyone but Miley's album, because that album was trash, John Batiste, because I don't, why? And then also, I'm okay with Boy Genius not winning Album of the Year as well, because I didn't like that album that much, so...
It was a weak category. It just wasn't a strong, like, offering. I think SZA was the one that people kind of wanted to win. Definitely people were also wanting Lana to win because Did You Know There's a Tunnel Under Ocean Boulevard? Even I, like some tracks off of that. Like, I had fun there.
I wanted that so badly. I also wanted it to acknowledge how Lana deserves Grammys but doesn't have any and has been passed over for them so many times. Like, I thought they were setting that up because they sat her next to Taylor. So I was thinking, oh, they have thought this out. Taylor could stand to lose Album of the Year And to Lana, that might be a cool moment. And yet, no, actually, we're going to make Lana lose again.
Yeah.
And she'll be seated next to the winner. So we'll have to watch that happen, which is uncomfortable as fuck.
Right. And then Taylor drags her on stage and it's very like, and then Celine Dion. Talk about Celine Dion.
Oh my God. Yeah. Because they tease it. They don't tell you Celine Dion is announcing the award until she's actually out there. But they were saying, oh, 5-time Grammy Award winner, the best vocalist ever. I was like, is it Celine Dion? Like, I thought that she is not able to do these types of things anymore. So then when she comes out looking incredible, looking like she feels incredible and like sounds incredible, we were gagged and we were so like, wow, thankful Celine Dion is here among us. That's incredible.
Right. Thunderous applause. Everyone is so excited to see her because she's famously diagnosed with this thing called stiff person syndrome. And every update from her camp has been like, she is struggling, but trying to move forward. She's having a really hard time. Don't expect her anytime soon. So to see her out there was like a huge miracle. So everyone's like loving Celine. And then
Taylor kind of pays her dust a bit, barely makes eye contact with her, plucks the Grammy out of Celine's hands and walks over to the mic and like does her thing and, you know, calls Lana a legacy artist, which is like, to me, I'm like, okay, shade. But yeah, so that was weird. And then everyone's kind of like, did she just kind of like snub Celine a little bit? And then immediately afterwards, like within like minutes, we get a picture of Taylor and Celine posed together in true tree pain fashion. So there you go. There you go.
Right.
So interesting here. Are we getting like the scent of a potential like Taylor Swift downturn or a tide turn? Do we say potential flop era?
I do feel like the response to Tortured Poets Department has been a little bit like, that's a very silly name for an album. And do we really need another one from you so soon? So it could be that we're seeing like light at the end of the tunnel a bit of like her being literally everywhere. And now she's broken this album of the year record. So it's like she has the record and it's like, we don't need to do anything else for her there. Like,
We got her to wherever we wanted her to go. Can we just
to go with an album that is not one of her best? Like that is not one that's like, wow, she really deserved that. Like
discography. Like,
right.
I feel like most people can acknowledge that Midnights is not her best work. So to have her break the record with this album feels very just, we just wanted to get her over the finish line. Kind of let's just get her there. But maybe the Tortured Poets Department will be exactly what we want. Maybe it will have all the songs we've ever wanted from her. Maybe it will break music and we won't need any more music again.
Maybe. Can't wait.
That'll be great. Okay.
That'll be so amazing. Okay, wait, the red carpet.
So one other floppy thing that was happening before the Grammys even started was the Grammys collaboration with IBM, specifically their Watson X AI technology to provide generative AI content and copy for the Grammy social channels as well as the Grammy Awards red carpet. So what this would look like was that AI stories with IBM, Watson X, that's the title of it all. It made text, images, and animations riffing off of the Grammys, of who's nominated, basically just describing a performer. It'll be like, this person is this person and they have this many awards. Or on the red carpet, the host would be talking to someone and they'd be like, oh, and by the way, the Grammys is partnering with IBM to provide you with AI generated content and blah, blah, blah about this artist like this. And then they'd show like a message and it would be just like the most like, this is this person and they've won this many awards. Okay. And then the artist is standing there like,
Was it just like flashing? It's like flashing on the CBS red carpet, or was it like tweeting too? Was it like tweeting from the Grammys account?
It was doing both because, you know, AI can just do everything.
Okay. Wow. And so was it on Instagram as well?
Yeah. It's on there. Some posts were generated by AI on their Instagram. Some were posted on YouTube to kind of show you the difference between this AI generated content and the content that's generated by gay guys on Twitter during the Grammys. I put together a little quiz.
Okay.
To kind of show you the difference and this fascinating narrative information that the AI generated for us that they keep talking about. So this is called AI or Gay Guy. I'm going to read you.
AI or Gay Guy. I'm so excited.
AI or Gay Guy. I am going to read you something written about the Grammys and you have to tell me whether it was written by their generative AI technology or a gay guy on Twitter. Okay.
I'm so excited.
Okay. So first question. Billie Eilish is a talented and influential artist whose music is a reflection of her generation, addressing topics such as mental health and social issues. Was that AI or gay guy?
AI.
Yes, correct. That was the generative AI technology put together that sentence. It's so incredible that it did that.
Sorry, I'm so... That's like the worst sentence that's ever happened to me. I'm so upset.
Mental health and social issues, yeah.
So, that's like a third grader practicing how to convey information.
A sentence and information, yes, exactly. Next question. Billie ate contaminated food at the Diva Buff Slay and had explosive slayeria, causing the mother toilet to overflow. Was that AI or gay guy?
I'm going to need a couple minutes here before I say with force, gay guy.
Could AI do this? Could AI come up with this?
Okay, next up.
What a medley of beautiful voices and music on the hashtag Grammys stage with Joni Mitchell. We cannot stop thinking about it. Was that AI or gay guy?
Gonna have to be AI.
Yes,
Alex.
That was AI. AI cannot stop thinking about that.
What a medley of beautiful voices. Don't and erase music. Brandi Carlile like that. Okay.
Okay, next up. Joni Mitchell committed diva rights violations at Serve Tonimo Slay. Was that AI or gay guy?
Gay guy. I hope Joni Mitchell never sees that. It's incredible. What was it? Serve Tonimo Slay?
Serve Tonimo Slay. Next up, Caroline Polachek is next in the line of Serve Session to be the chief executive mother of Slay Star Serve Co. Was that AI or gay guy?
That's going to be gay guy who loves Succession.
Yes, that's gay guy. The rare crossover of Caroline Polachek listener and Succession enjoyer.
Enjoyer, yes. Great.
Great. That was my quiz, AI or... So you can get a taste of kind of what this AI was doing. It was writing copy that is usually a good gig for writers to have during award shows.
Right. I would say it was doing like 300-400 steps below writing copy. I would say it was just like labeling.
Right. Yes. It was doing like the thing that a social media manager who's like super busy is like, fuck, I have to do this too. Okay, I'm just gonna do it now. And like it's like part of their job, but they do it because it's their job. And it's like now it's AI's job, I guess. So there you go. They were making such a big deal. They probably paid so much money to have
By the way, somebody tell SZA how much water AI generating captions take up away from the trees.
How many seeds do you need to send me, SZA, so I can make up for IBM's crimes?
So we can offset the AI generated Grammy tweets.
So delicious.
I just love that. It's just like every event now has some weird twist like this where it's like, oh, and by the way, AI also did this. Did you know? And it's like, kind of, yeah, actually, that was a little weird.
It's like, yep, yeah. I'm pretty sure that I know that AI did that.
So yeah, those are the Grammys. That's our Grammy recap, touching it in all different areas.
It was better than it has been from a concert perspective, and mid as hell from like a Here's Who Gets an Award perspective. And definitely better from a It's on Sunday and not Monday perspective. Because it was on Monday for many years. So
for us sickos who love to have little watch parties of award shows.
Right. You can't have a little watch party on Monday nights because that's when Flop Soup gets recorded.
Inside baseball.
So thank God it was on Sunday.
Next up, we have our local flops for this week.
Ooh, local flops. Okay. We're in Philadelphia now, bitch. Okay, so a little context here. Just in the culture at large, there's been sort of a weird comeback of like speed dating and like singles mixers. Do you have any thoughts about that? Is that happening in Los Angeles?
Yeah. I mean, everyone's saying dating in LA is really bad right now. I don't know why it was, when was it ever good? But I do think people are kind of being in a place of, I want to get off the apps. So
yeah, like I hit a wall with Tinder. Yes.
Yeah. But we don't have any like quote unquote third places anymore. So I guess we have to do speed
dating. We have to have like events. Like they have to be like at a place.
We're not bumping into each other at bookstores.
So. We're not like talking to people. We're not striking up conversation because we're scared we're gonna get me too'd or whatever. It's like I feel like that's what every guy
hello,
like,
HR.
Oh, I can't talk to a woman because what if she thinks I'm doing me too? It's like I don't know. You have to resolve that on your own. Anyway.
Look
so,
at your life and your choices.
Right. Think hard about that. It's been coming back. I've seen like I read a lot of like local Philadelphia newsletters that have like little events listed at the bottom, and there's like all these singles ones. Like I've seen posters for queer ones, straight ones, both, whatever, the whole nine yards. So I also wanted to mention that there's one specific one that looks fun. That's like you come with a PowerPoint and you pitch your friend as like a single person that should get dated. And that's been going like super popular all over Philadelphia. Anyway, that's not the flop. That's none of this is the flop. If this is how you want to date, I'm happy for you. I would love to be a fly on the wall at one of these.
Right.
Sounds very fun. But I was looking at a newsletter today and there was this singles mixer called, quote, Date Them. And I'm like, mm-hmm. Oh my God, a non-binary speed dating event. That's so fun.
Slay, yes, mama.
That's so great. So I'm clicking on it. I'm like, that's crazy. Yeah. It's at the Pyramid Club, which is this like club at the top of one of the tallest skyscrapers in the city. I'm like, that is so crazy that the non-binary dating mixer gets to happen at this fancy club. And then I start reading the description and it's like, okay, so here's the rules. You can purchase a solo ticket or bring a single friend of the opposite sex ticket to purchase your ticket at a discounted rate. And I'm like, this is not a non-binary
thing. This is gender
event.
Happening.
This is gender happening hardcore. And they've given it the dumbest name possible for like a straight singles event. So I thought that was really floppy. I'm like, you really called it Date Them. Date Them.
There's so many other things to work with in the singles mixer title space.
Just call it like them. Sexy singles, like singles right. PHL. Like
if anything, they stole this from a potential non-binary singles mixer
right.
that doesn't exist yet, but should
that
exist.
It doesn't exist yet, but it should exist, and they need this name. They
right.
need this name.
Yeah. So it's really taking up a lot of space in a really problematic and toxic way.
I'm not to be so progressive, but I was like, at first I was like,
not
if you're
so
not
progressive.
If you're
we
non-binary
so
what is the opposite sex? Like when I was reading it before I understood that it was like obviously for like the most cis hetero people ever, I was like, how, what would the
like,
opposite
wait, I'm being
be
challenged here? My norms are being challenged.
Like what is the opposite? That is such a funny way to say that. And then I'm like, nope, this is not friendly to
for
that
the
so anyway, so that's just yeah, that's a little eye into what it's like to be single right now. Honestly, it does seem better than apps. It seems better than apps to just go to an event and be like, I know what everybody's doing here. Single people, I wish you all the best. Go to a mixer.
They should do like a cheaters mixer.
Oh, yes.
But like in
love
person.
That idea.
Because I feel like cheaters only exist in the digital space.
It is so amazing to hear you invent swinging on the podcast.
But like, let's get the swingers.
You're like,
back.
And they could all, there should be like a bowl and everybody puts their watches or their keys in there. And
right.
then
but like,
there's like an exchange.
I'm talking cheating. Like, they,
yeah, you're
like
good
go,
old fashioned.
Yeah.
Like, swingers do it together. They're copacetic. The whole thing is fine. No, I know what you're saying. And that's AshleyMadison.com only, I guess. So they need yeah. Ashley Madison, the mixer.
IRL.
Bring old fashioned cheating back.
Cheating.
Good
cheating
old
lifestyle.
Fashioned.
The Wild West.
I mean, I'm looking to cheat. Are you? Give us your California flap.
Quick one. Brian Johnson. Does that name mean something to you? Well, it shouldn't.
No.
So it's that billionaire who's trying to look reverse aged but is more and more looking like a Bushwick DJ. Yeah,
wait, I thought, wait, is it the guy who, like, I thought everyone was saying he kind of looks like he's trying to transition to be a woman.
He's giving, yeah, it's kind of non-binary singles mixer sometimes.
He's kind
Brian
of like
Johnson.
Looking like he wants to go to an event called Dating Them.
And no, it's funny too, because if you look up Brian Johnson too, you see images of him before his journey, and he does just look like your very like cis straight venture capitalist guy.
Yeah.
And then slowly he's morphed into kind of like a reptilian, like hair slicked back. But he holds these hikes called like Don't Die as part of his blueprint for reverse aging company project thing. So it's called the Don't Die hike. And they all happen on like the same day across the country. And I just observed that one took place in LA, and it's the one that he goes to because he lives in LA. And I was curious just how many people have been roped into this. And apparently a lot, because 500 people RSVP'd to the event and 200 people showed up. You won't catch me hiking, but that sounds awful to be like confronted with a bunch of anti-aging theorist, weird billionaire scientist guy as you're just trying to get like a hike in
just
Los Angeles.
Right. That's, it's like a like, parade of people who are like, do you have enough SPF on? And you're like,
and it's not even just like SPF. It's like, we're replacing our blood with young blood. We are putting monitors on our penises to make sure that they can get erect and that they can like get erect at the same velocity as a 21-year-old's can. It's wackadoodle time. I just thought it was floppy that this took place in LA and so many people came, but also I shouldn't be totally surprised, but I didn't know that he had this many people following him is the thing. I didn't know that there were this many people who were subscribing to his beliefs, which he calls like the blueprint or something for anti-aging. But yeah, they all are wearing like don't die in big white don't letters die. Across black shirts.
It's so crazy to know this guy's name. First of all, and it's amazing the way it sounds AI generated. Brian Johnson.
Brian Johnson.
That's fake.
Johnson.
Not
and
a
Johnson.
Real guy. Come on.
No. Everything that he's done to himself hasn't made him look actually younger.
No, he doesn't look younger.
Yeah, it's just made him look like next to the age that he is. It just makes him look like a different person who is the same age that he is. Like,
right, that he already was. He looks slimier, as you said, more reptilian.
Right.
For sure.
Yeah.
Like just paler, like more dead-eyed.
You don't want to look slimy. You want to look dewy. Hello.
You don't,
like that's
he
what
looks,
the snail mucin is for.
He looks cold to the touch.
Cold
like,
to the touch.
Very literally. Mm. Like it's, you look at a photo of him and you're like, that guy looks like he's really, really needs a blankie.
Blankie. It's blankie time.
It's blankie time for Brian Johnson. Oh, God. I can't believe that many people went on the hike. First of all,
it's
I would
so
love...
Stupid.
I would love demographics like for every city, like how many people are going.
Yeah, it's definitely a different city. I'm sure LA also had like the highest numbers of these hikes too.
The
because
highest people
that's
turned
just,
out.
That's just LA coded to be like fearful of aging and death.
I
didn't know it was all
on.
Framed as like, don't die. I thought it's like, let's die when we're supposed to, but like, let's look young and be able to fuck as long as we want. I thought that
no,
was the goal. I didn't realize we were trying
forever.
To cheat death.
He's trying
crazy.
To cheat death. He's trying to cheat death. So maybe he doesn't care God. That he looks reptilian as long as he gets to be like 107. By the way, don't die in quotes, hikes Philadelphia did not turn up anything to do with him. So that's interesting. Okay, just in case anybody
that's
was wondering.
So good for Philadelphia.
That's so good for Philadelphia.
Hats off
I,
to y'all.
Do you have more to say about this?
Not really. I mean, there's a op-ed or a piece about the hike from someone who went, who was like asking him questions like, you know, is this important? Like,
is this really what we should all be doing with our time? Or
and to that he said yes. Yeah, he's wearing like all these weird trackers. I don't know.
Yeah, he's insane. I love the Eternal idea of life. Asking like a narcissist, should they be like narcissizing? Like,
you know, no one's ever asked me that. You're right. I should stop. I should stop everything that
right,
I've been
you're right.
raised to believe.
I'm like so focused on myself to the detriment of everyone around me, probably. You're so right. I never thought about it before.
He has little dad hats you can buy that say don't die on them that are black. Yeah, he looks sinewy. How about that word?
He does sinewy? Look very sinewy. Yeah.
Sinewy. So that's a local flop for you, just that this is happening. And it might be local to you too, because how many are there? Like, there's a lot. I don't know.
Does he fly to them all? That's like another. I hope he's like on a private jet with Kyrsten Sinema. Like, we're at the Phoenix one.
I think he prioritizes the LA one because he knows that LA residents are most susceptible to these types of
are most obsessed with no
thinkings.
Aging. They're like, I brought baby Botox to the Don't Die hike.
This is Satan's work.
That's only the tip of the
that.
Iceberg,
truly, yeah,
truly, of the Don't Die iceberg.
Truly.
Quote from him that he told the person who wrote the piece. For the first time in the history of Homo sapiens, it's possible to say with a straight face that death may no longer be inevitable. Great. At a certain point, it's like we should just reach a point where we're just like, yeah, you know what? I've lived a life.
Like, yeah, people are gonna die. Just terrible, but like inevitable.
We need to know that it's going to end at some point.
That it will end at some point. This guy has clones. I'm sure of
Yeah,
it.
he's got the clones on deck. He's got his dogs cloned. He's
Right.
got
They
it
keep
all.
coming out and being like, the monkeys are cloned and they're living. Like, this guy has a human cloned. Okay. Well, that, and I think that's it on Local Flops.
That's it on Local Flops,
That's
and
it
that's
on
it
Local
for Flop Soup
Flops.
this week.
That is, except I have one addendum, which is that Taylor Swift has unveiled the track list for her new album, The Tortured Poets Department, and
No.
it includes collaborations with Florence and the Machine and
No.
Post Malone.
Get a good lawyer.
What?
Post Malone.
What the fuck are you talking about? What do you
Post
mean?
Malone.
What do you mean, Florence and the Machine and Post Malone? Also, putting Florence and the Machine on your album is not a guaranteed win. We saw what
Oh
happened to
no.
Joanne. Okay,
Oh no, it's not a guaranteed
that was
win.
not a good time.
By the way, oh my God, the Post Malone song is called Fortnite. Those are the only two features.
No. Oh my God. You know what's crazy? This track list actually leaked like months ago on TikTok, but no one took it seriously because it sounded so
It's so
stupid.
stupid.
It leaked
I am
so long
so
ago and they said
obsessed.
it. Oh my God.
I'm
And they
fucking
leaked
obsessed
this.
with you knowing that, with you like eyeballing it and you're like, this was on TikTok.
How about Florida three
And three
exclamation
exclamation
points?
points.
Oh no. She's really trying to do some type of Lana type of thing, and it's highlighting how you can't just do that. You
Right.
can't.
Right. These
Like,
album titles are all serving like too long. My boy only breaks his favorite toys.
this is so fucking stupid. The
I can
alchemy,
fix your
okay,
parentheses
stealing
now, really. I
chemistry.
can.
Bonus
Yeah,
track, the manuscript.
truly. So
Bonus track, what
please.
do you mean? This is the standard edition
This
of
is
the
the
album.
standard edition of the album. It's not a bonus track. Stop calling stuff that.
So Long, London.
So long, London, boy.
Oh my God, I don't give a
Boy.
fuck. Okay, it's over. We're
Ouch.
done.
You look so dumb right now.
No,
Oh
turning in
my
the
God. One of them is called
cards on the table.
Fresh Out the Slammer. She's canceled.
Okay, like
Taylor Swift,
this
one of your
is
promises to the
wait,
money
the
god should have
police
been you
department.
don't say the slammer. The police
Fresh
department.
out the slam, not out of the
Fresh
slammer. We're saying
out
out
the
the
slammer.
slammer.
Fresh out the slammer.
Guilty as sin, question mark. And then, okay, you can't have two songs back to back on your track list that both have exclamation
Qu
part
question
or
question marks.
exclamation.
Question
Sorry.
marks.
You can't
Justin
have.
is in a tizzy.
Oh my God. Clara Bow. I
I
don't
don't
give
know
a
what that
fuck.
is. Also, have you clocked yet? LOML, all lowercase, love of my life, LOML. Is that gonna be about Travis?
No, because I couldn't. There's so much here that
There's so
is.
much to be done and said.
And there
I'm
is a
so glad I
song called The
noticed this
Tortured
before
Poets
we
Department.
logged up. There is a song, it's the second song, right after Fortnite feat Post Malone, which I can only imagine is a song that Post Malone wrote about Fortnite.
Fortnite is
Because
spelled differently.
I know, okay, but sure it is.
But
I'm sure it is.
she's referring
I'm
to the
actually
concept
sure.
of a 2 weeks,
2 weeks.
but
She's re
yeah.
referring to 2 weeks.
But I also did forget that there is something else. Anyway,
Yeah.
file name the manuscript. What is with this postage? Oh my
I
God.
don't
Oh my
know.
God.
I
Oh
don't
my
know.
God.
I
Oh
don't
my God.
know. What are
Oh
we
my
gonna
God.
do?
This is
Cassette editions.
so.
I can't wait to get
I
my
think
cassette
she's.
of this.
Oh,
I
wait,
can't
yeah.
wait to
How many
play my
fucking.
cassette to hear Florida three exclamation points featuring Florence and the Machine.
Of course, she tweets out the track list and a link to her fucking merch store. Oh
Is
my
the merch
God.
ugly? Is the merch ugly? We can't scream
It's
kill yourself, Taylor
all.
Swift. She's gonna kill us.
Get a good lawyer.
It's all sepia. It's all black and white sepia-esque. This is so. I'm turning my card in. I'm done.
We're done with being Swifties. We're not, but
No,
we.
I can't. I'm like frozen in amber Swiftie. Like I'm of a time Swiftie, but it's
Yeah.
only of that time. It's
Of
no
that time.
longer. It's
Yeah.
not into the future. It stopped at Evermore. Okay.
It's right. It's done.
It stopped at the last
It
album.
really did.
These antics have to conclude.
Hold on. I'm just like looking at the
I'm
merch
calling the
page.
police.
It's so ugly. But she's the police. That's the
She's
problem. She's the
that's
police department.
she's the police of she's fascism. She controls the freeways, the highways, the commerce, the feminism.
I can't wait to tell like a Gen X person that Taylor Swift is selling a cassette for $19.99 for her next album. Like, I can't wait to tell a 52-year-old that.
Let's say how many copies it's going to sell in its first week. I'm going to say 1.2 million at least.
Is that like the most possible?
Midnight's did 1.4, I think. Or,
Ah.
yeah.
Okay, I hope it is less than that. Post Malone. Post
Post
Malone.
Malone. Well, guess what? We are post Taylor Swift.
and we're post this episode, we have to stop. It has to be over. We're
the horrors never cease.
The horrors That's what are we not found. Ceasing. The flops are never ceasing. Our own personal one, flopping.
We took 1 week off and it all went to hell.
It all went to hell. Basket. By the way, we haven't even been able to really, we didn't have any time to say Nicki Megan, but
no.
Everything because, is.
I mean, we're already on to the next.
We're on to the next.
It's just as bad.
And it's Post Malone is on the Police Department album.
Okay.
That's it. Justin and Cassandra are flopping off. Bye.
Good fucking bye.
Really had me going, but now it's time to go. Curtains fall.